Wonderful. Thank you on this chilly, chilly Reformation Sunday. Welcome, everyone. Thank you, bells. It's always good to have you play for us. And we have bells, we have brass, we have choir, and I think the hello, choir's waving at me, and the organ is even going to pull out some trumpet sounds, I do believe. But I want to give a special thank you to our brass team that we don't usually see, except on these high festive days. And so playing with the bells this morning is Don Jan. So Don Jan, thank you on the horn, on the trumpet. We also have Howard Sonstegard on a trumpet. We had Klaus Kirschner on the trombone and John Reed on trombone. So thank you for ringing in this Reformation Sunday. And so many of you are wearing red, and I'm wearing red. I was actually gifted, this is the first time wearing this stole. I was gifted this when I traveled to the Holy Land last April, and it's a handmade stole that I will treasure, and I know that we're keeping all of the people, the good people in the Holy Land, Palestinians, Israelis, in our prayers. But anyway, so I'm excited to be able to wear my red stole today. Also, I'm excited that Pastor Mark Brocker will be with us, the Reverend Dr. Mark Brocker, who is St. Luke's Theologian in Residence. And Pastor Mark will be our guest preacher today. We had a wonderful session with him yesterday morning. Some of you were there, where we had a Bonhoeffer ethics workshop. And I learned a lot about Bonhoeffer that I didn't know before. And also we had workshopping of how we had a case study, and we learned how to make responsible decisions. And so it was just really fruitful, and I thank you for that. We're blessed to have you, Pastor Mark. Thank you. Thank you. And his wife Donna is here too. So we are blessed to have that family as a part of and members of St. Luke. Also, just want to remind you that this Wednesday is November 1st, which means that we have our Wednesday church night. Come at 6 o'clock for delicious food that will be prepared by Chef Valerie Brennis. And so you'll not want to miss that. Dinner will be followed by the first of three workshops led by Karen O'Brien on Bible readers, workshops, scripture readers. Karen, you will know her as you attend this 10:30 service. She is one of our Bible lesson readers. She's excellent. She's a professional voice actress and wants to give and share her techniques and skills with you so that ministry can be opened up to you. So if you've been on kind of the edge of like, oh, I don't really have the confidence to do that, please come to these workshops because we need many voices to share the word. So that starts this Wednesday after dinner, as well as those of you who decide not to do that workshop, you can stay for a movie that will be shown called Once a Braided River. And the documentarian Barbara Bernstein will be with us on Wednesday night to share with us about this film that she made. It deals with climate change that you will hear in the sermon a bit about today also. So we want to keep that in our forefront and learn why and how and what we can do to bring this earth back to its healthy place. Now, it is Reformation Sunday, which means what? We have not only Pastor Mark as our special guest, but we have a visitor from the past who has somehow, I don't know, transmuted to this earthly plane again. And I'm very happy to welcome Martin Luther.
Woo-hoo! Good morning. I would say it's magic, but that would be worrisome. Good friends, I have returned to beautiful Portland, St. Luke. It's a lot longer than my 1,000-mile walk to Rome that I did in my life. I have been here several years now, and occasionally I feel just a bit like a relic. So I asked Pastor Patty, how could I help? First, I offered to preach. I have a number of sermons, a perfect length, approximately 150 minutes, 2.5 hours that I'm sure you would love to hear. But Pastor Patty informed me that my preaching style might just be a bit dated. And anyway, St. Luke has a far more qualified theologian in residence who will be preaching today in Dr. Mark Brocker. She then said I should consider helping the church with its finances, as there are currently needs in several areas, such as lay volunteer positions, a co-church treasurer, a trust fund treasurer, a finance committee chairperson, as well as a staff position for bookkeeping and a payroll specialist. And of course, I'm always willing to serve. So I asked for my abacus. There was no abacus. Pastor Patty informed me of this modern thing called a spreadsheet. And so I'm always willing to try new things, and so this is what I came up with for the church budget. It didn't quite add up. And if you note, I did spend $110,095 on swivel chairs. I apologize, but I really enjoy swivel chairs. It's the best technology of the 21st century. They spin and I go, wee! So, needless to say, I was reassigned, and that's probably a good thing. I'm gonna take a 40-day break from spreadsheets. I will call it my Excel Lent. Get that? Wunderbar. Just wish Pastor Beth was here for that one. So if you have the skill to fill one of these extremely important positions, I encourage you to contact the nominating committee or the pastoral staff to let them know of your interest so that you can save Luke from my financial mismanagement and send me back to where I belong in the past. Thank you all.
Thank you, Martin. It's always a thrill to have you here at St. Luke. And do take Martin's words to heart. We are looking for financial volunteers. And if you have been contacted, we would love it if you would prayerfully consider responding to the contact and then also responding to the needs that we have as church treasurers, as well as finance committee chair, trust fund treasurer. And we also are looking for a bookkeeper and payroll specialist, which is a staff position. So I commend that to you. Thank you. Now, let us settle ourselves for this wonderful continued Reformation Sunday worship. And I invite you to rise as we offer our confession. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus, who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete. Amen. Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others, for the harm we have caused, known and unknown. Forgive us for the unjust demands we place on others and your creation. Forgive us for the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor. Forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. And in Christ, you are already forgiven. Amen.
Oh, my dear, for trust is our God.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty and God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel. And bestow on the church your saving peace through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading this morning is from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah, beginning with verse 31. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Word of God, word of life. Second reading is from the third chapter of Romans, beginning with verse 19. Paul writes, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Chapter. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." And they answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Lord
Christ.
You may be seated. Well, I was warned it might be a little cool in the sanctuary today. I suspect it was, this time of year would have been quite cold at the Castle Church in Wittenberg back in the days when Martin Luther was preaching there. As you heard Martin share with us, he liked to preach long sermons. The good news is this will be about a 12-minute sermon. Beloved people of God, grace and peace to you from Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, if the ghost of Martin Luther were to return on a Reformation Sunday, perhaps he would wonder what we Lutherans were making so much fuss about. Luther once said, "I ask that people make no reference to my name. Let them call themselves Christians, not Lutherans. What is Luther? After all, the teaching is not mine. Neither was I crucified for anyone. St. Paul in 1 Corinthians 3 would not allow the Christians to call themselves Pauline or Petrine, but Christian. How then could I, poor stinking maggot fodder that I am, come to have people call the children of Christ by my wretched name? Not so, my dear friends. Let us abolish all party names and call ourselves Christians after him whose teaching we hold." Obviously, we Lutherans didn't listen to Luther very well. Now, according to tradition, Luther posted his 95 theses on the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg on October 31st, 1517. His intent was not to begin a new church. He wanted to reform the church by ending the sale of indulgences. He believed that the common people were being sold a bill of goods. In late 1515, Pope Leo X proclaimed what's called a plenary indulgence, in large part to rebuild St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. A plenary indulgence provided remission of all punishment due to sin. It seemed as if salvation were being put up for sale. Now, as a young zealous monk, Luther had agonized over his inability to fulfill the demands of a wrathful God. The breakthrough for him was his discovery of God's amazing grace. During his so-called tower experience, Luther pored over Romans 1, 16 and 17, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed through faith for faith, as it is written, the one who is righteous will live by faith." The gospel of Jesus Christ revealed to Luther a gracious God who loves us unconditionally. Salvation is a gift from this gracious God. It's not for sale. It is not a commodity on the religious market. Now, for the 500th anniversary of the Reformation in 2017, the people of Holy Trinity Catholic Church in Cedar Hills joined the people of St. Andrew Lutheran, also in Cedar Hills, for a commemorative service at Holy Trinity. It was well attended by Catholics and Lutherans. It was a sign that many Catholics and Lutherans are waking up in our time to our fundamental unity in the gospel. It is on the basis of this fundamental gospel unity that Pope John XXIII, who called the historic Vatican II Council in 1962, uttered his inspiring words, "The things that unite us are greater than the things that divide us." And just to add observation, I know that St. Luke has a history of cultivating relationships with Catholics, and you have the St. John Fisher Catholic Church right here next door. Luther did not believe that the Reformation of the Church was a one-time event or historical period. One of the classic Reformation principles is ecclesia semper reformanda est. That is, the church is always being reformed. The church is being reformed today just as much as it was being reformed in the time of Luther. Reformation is not about so much about us reforming the church. It is about waking up to how God is reforming the church so that we can participate with God in that reforming process. Yes, Luther was a leader in the Reformation, but his key contribution was his insight into the gospel of Jesus Christ as the power of God's reforming of the church. For Luther, the gospel of Jesus Christ was the lens through which he interpreted all of Scripture. In John 8, 31 and 32, which I just read, Jesus tells his followers, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." Jesus' word assures us that we are liberated by grace. But the truth of Jesus Christ also exposes that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Ongoing reformation includes an honest, truth-telling assessment of where the truth has fallen short, as well as a celebration of our liberation by grace. In Luther's 1543 treatise on the Jews and their lies, he labeled Jews as dishonest heathens and expressed hope that German political leaders would seize their prayer books and torch their synagogues and homes. Nazi henchmen literally fulfilled Luther's hope on the night of November 9, 1938, the so-called Night of Broken Glass. In the account of this night, published by the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, They offer this horrifying description of what happened. In the hours and days that followed, organized groups of Nazis wreaked havoc on Jewish life in Nazi Germany. During the riot, local Nazis set hundreds of synagogues on fire. They vandalized thousands of Jewish-owned businesses. They desecrated Jewish cemeteries. They broke into homes, smashed furniture, and terrorized Jewish families. Following orders given by Nazi leaders, police forces and fire brigades did not intervene to stop the destruction. Policemen did not protect Jews or their property. Firemen did not put out fires in synagogues. Now, for German Lutheran pastor and professor Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who would himself eventually be executed by the Nazis, the night of broken glass was the low point in the church struggle against the Nazis. Bonhoeffer was deeply saddened by the silence of church leaders against the Nazi persecution of the Jews. In his devotional Bible, he underlined Psalm 74, verse 8b. They burned all the meeting places of God in the land. Beside it, in the margin, he wrote November 9th, 1938. He also underlined the next verse. We do not see our signs. There is no longer any prophet, and there is no one among us who knows how long. The lack of a strong response by the church to this catastrophe was likely a factor in Bonhoeffer getting involved in a conspiracy to assassinate Adolf Hitler. The extermination of millions of Jews was yet to come. Now, in April of 1994, our own Evangelical Lutheran Church in America formally apologized for Luther's anti-Semitic writings and for the ways those writings were used to persecute Jews in Nazi Germany and elsewhere. Grieving the complicity of our own tradition within this history of hatred, declared the 1994 ELCA statement, we express our urgent desire to live out our faith in Jesus Christ with love and respect for the Jewish people. In Bonhoeffer's Ethics, written during the early years of World War II, when Hitler and the Nazis were at the height of their power, Bonhoeffer affirms that the central message of the New Testament is that in Christ, God has loved the world and reconciled it with himself. God does not love some ideal world, but the real world, the lost and condemned world. God's acceptance of this lost and condemned world, asserts Bonhoeffer, is a miracle of divine mercy. According to Bonhoeffer, there is no part of the world, no matter how lost, no matter how godless, that has not been accepted by God in Jesus Christ and reconciled to God. Now, though we are part of this lost and condemned world, God has given us the capacity to love as God has first loved us. We are instructed to look to Jesus and discern what it means to seek the well-being of our world and all its inhabitants. We may not be Jesus, but Bonhoeffer was confident that we can participate in what he referred to as Jesus's greatness of heart. Now, the most pressing issue in Bonhoeffer's time was how to stop Hitler and his Nazi cohorts. Bonhoeffer would have us ask, what is the most pressing issue for us today? All other issues, as important as they may be and as important as it may be to address them, all these, even the violent conflicts in the Middle East and in Ukraine, all these issues pale in comparison to the impending ecological catastrophe that we face. Now, I was actually putting this sermon together in August in the immediate aftermath of the wildfires on Maui. I must confess that the Hawaiian Islands are one of the last places I would have anticipated wildfires breaking out. What happened there was horrifying, a wake-up call to the ecological challenges we face. Now, although Bonhoeffer had a wonderful vision of the community of God, human beings, and all God's creatures, he did not address ecological issues to any great extent. Nevertheless, his affirmation of the love of God for the world in the midst of the carnage of World War II and the Holocaust offers an inspiring model for the affirmation of the love of God for the world in the midst of the carnage of the current ecological crisis. The church and the whole world need to wake up to the destructive ecological path we are on. But it's not enough simply to wake up. People have to be moved in the depths of their being to change an entrenched way of life. Such motivation has to be grounded in something as deep as God's love for our earth home and all its inhabitants, both human and non-human. At Christmas time, 1942, less than 4 months prior to Bonhoeffer's arrest, he wrote an essay for his fellow conspirators entitled After 10 Years, that is, After 10 Years Under Nazi Rule. In this essay, he lamented the lack of civil courage among Germans in resisting the Nazis. He acknowledged that what he and his fellow conspirators had done and were doing may not have been a good response, but actually a very tardy one. He identified the ultimately responsible question as, how is the coming generation to go on living? Those who are concerned about the coming generation today, we will need to address the ecological question. Bonhoeffer added this warning. He said, only from such a historically responsible question will fruitful solutions arise, however humiliating they may be for the moment. He concludes with this observation. The younger generation will always have the surest sense whether an action is responsible, for it is their future that is at stake. In our time and place, an ever-reforming, responsible church will have the courage to address the ecological question head-on, or at least have the humility to let the younger generation take the lead in addressing it. As we engage in the ongoing reformation of our church and our world, how good it is to know that we do so in the presence of a God who dearly loves us and the whole beloved earth community. In Jesus' name.
Please rise.
Thank you.
please join with me as we affirm our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in the transformative power of God's love, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God, you call us your children and have made us siblings through your Son, Jesus. Heal the church, its many divisions. Bring understanding and peace where there has been contention and strife, and unite us in one body through the love of Christ. In your mercy, God, our Creator, in your hands you made the heights of the mountains, the depths of the sea, and the life that animates all creation. Bring relief to areas harmed by wildfires, floods, storms, and human carelessness. Renew the face of the earth. God, in your mercy. God, our ruler, the nations rage and the kingdoms shake, but your word stands fast forever. Let your justice and peace roll down like waters wherever there is strife, injustice, war, or religious conflict, especially in the Holy Land. We also lift up in prayer the Ukraine war. God, in your mercy. God, our reformer, you make all things new. Free us from complacency, open us to unexpected ways, and kindle zeal for us in the future. We pray for young people affirming their baptism, and with them we stir in us a desire for your wisdom. God, in your mercy. Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and amazing grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
May the peace of God be always with you.
And also with you.
I apologize to all for my cold hands. I'm grateful for your warm hands. Just before we hear from the bells again and receive return to God, you may be seated, that which was first given us. We are, as you prepare your hearts for communion, we are returning to the practice of communion by intinction today. So we will have communion assistants join Pastor Mark and myself. There will be one chalice with wine and one chalice with grape juice on each side. And you are welcome to receive the body of Christ and intinct it or dip it into one or the other of the chalices. The wine is red, the grape juice is golden. And also, if you are not inclined to intinct, that is not a problem, because communing by bread alone is fully communing, sufficient enough. So I commend that to you, and now I turn it over to our beautiful bell choir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please rise as we offer our prayer. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. You may be seated.
Thank you.
join me in our post-communion prayer. Blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word, Christ Jesus, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May the peace which passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds on the love of God and on his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you all the days of your life. Amen. In you.